भव शंकर देशिक मे शरणम् 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 विदिताखिल शास्त्र सुधा जलधे महितोपनिषद्कथितार्थनिधे हृदये कलये विमलं चरणं भव शंकर देशिक मे शरणं भव शंकर देशिक मे शरणं भव शंकर देशिक मे शरणं भव शंकर देशिक मे शरणम् भव शंकर देशिक मे शरणम्
ॐ सहना भवतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शांति शांति शांति। सदाशिव समारंभां शंकराचार्य मध्यमां अस्मदाचार्य पर्यन्तां वंदे गुरु परंपरां। नमस्ते टू द लिसनर्स ऑफ दिस टॉक सीरीज मेंट टू प्रोपगेट द works and teachings of Adi Shankara, the shining link in the Advaita tradition of Vedanta. If we have some Vishnu Shastra, we owe it to Adi Shankara, because without his Bhashya, the Vyakhyanam Sandhi, Upanishads, Bhagavad Gita and Brahma Sutra, we would have lost this teaching tradition. We can repay our debt by keeping this tradition alive and passing it on to the next generation. I appreciate the efforts of the Department of Culture, Government of Madhya Pradesh, in this direction. I express my gratitude to them for giving me this opportunity to be part of their efforts. Coming to the topic of the current talk, it is very crucial. One, Kshetra and Kshetrajna. We will explore this topic based on the Vyakhyanam of Acharya Shankara. In the Bhagavad Gita, we have the 13th chapter dedicated to this topic, Kshetra Kshetrajna Vibhaga Yoga, a chapter that distinctly unfolds the two words Kshetra, the body, and Kshetrajna, the knower of the body. Acharya calls it Kshetra Kshetrajna Jneya Bhutau, to be known. One is to be known for giving up, and the other is to be known for owning up. There are only two padarthas to be inquired into. One is idam, this, and the other aham, I. One is whatever that is subject to becoming the object of the world, this idam shabda, and this thought idam pratyaya. The other is the content of the word I aham shabda and I thought aham pratyaya. Acharya would call it yushmat pratyaya gochara and asmat pratyaya gochara in his famous Adhyasa Bhashya on Brahma Sutra. These two are discussed in the 13th chapter as Kshetra and Kshetrajna. Lord Krishna introduces the Kshetra in the First verse is idam shariram kaunteya kshetramitya vidhiyate. This body is called kshetra. Kshetra means a place, specifically a place of pilgrimage or a place of cultivation. The Gita opens with dharma kshetre, kuru kshetre. This body is called kshetra, the place wherein you can reap the fruits of punya and papa, and is therefore a dharma kshetra. And it is a karma kshetra because being endowed with a free will, you are qualified to do karma. So, shariram here refers to human body only, that is qualified for karma. Later in this chapter, Lord is going to expand on this word kshetra to include any object. Then, why the Lord is confining the word kshetra to body only here in these words? It is because while I do not take any object as myself, I take the body as myself. So, there is no confusion, therefore no viveka is necessary to distinguish myself from the objects. I do not need to be told very seriously, you are not a table. Since there is no confusion of taking the table as myself, no viveka is necessary. Bhagavan begins right at the locus of our aviveka, the physical body, which is taken as myself. Explaining why the body is called a kshetra, Acharya Shankara says, kshetravadva asmin karma phala nishpattehe. In this body, one accomplishes results of action, like in a field. In a field, one undertakes various activities such as plowing, sowing the seeds, watering the crops, and so on. And finally, reaps the result of harvest in time. So too, one performs various actions through the body and get the results in time. So body is called kshetra. Mind also is kshetra because mind also is a means for performing actions and reaping results in the form of happiness and sorrow. Another reason Acharya gives is this. The human body is a kshetra because it saves you from falling down. Kshatranat. With this human form, you are capable of following dharma and therefore gathering punya, which will save you from falling into the body of a lower life form. It can give you moksha also. That is why this body is a place of pilgrimage. Whether it helps you save yourself relatively or absolutely from samsara, it deserves to be called a kshetra. Lord elaborately deals with the word kshetra in verse 5 and 6. Mahabhutanyahankarah buddhiravyaktamevacha indriyani dashaikamcha panchachendriya gocharah iccha dveshasukam dukkam sanghatascetana dhriti etat kshetram samasena savikaram udhasrutam. While explaining verse 5, Acharya says all the 24 tattvas of Sankhyas are covered by the word kshetra. The five great subtle elements, ahankara, mahat buddhi, and avyakta maya, which form eightfold prakriti, and the 11 organs, including the mind, plus the five Indriya Gochara objects representing the five gross elements, total 24. Therefore, Shankara says, Tan Yetani Sankhya Chaturvimshati Tattvani Achakshate Iti. The verse 6 that lists the modifications of mind, Icha Dvesha Sukham Dukkam Sanghatas Chetana Dhritihi, they cover all the eight Atma Gunas of Vaisheshikas, says Shankara. Atha Idani Atma Gunaha Iti Yan Achakshate Vaisheshikaha Tepi Kshetra Dharmaha Eva Natu Kshetra Jnasya Iti, he says. For the word Kshetra therefore covers everything that one can objectify. Thus, the whole jagat is covered by the word Kshetra. The other word to be known is Kshetrajna. It means the one who knows the body. Eta Kshetram Shariram Yo Vetti Vijanati Apada Talamastakam Jnanena Vishayi Karoti. Iti Shankara says, one who objectifies from the sole of the feet to the top of the head is Kshetrajna. The entire body up to the extremities is known as conscious, because one sense organ, the sense of touch, is all over the body. It reveals the Chaitanya Atma, which is the Swarupa nature of the Kshetrajna. Because of Kshetrajna alone, the body is an object of knowledge. He is the one who objectifies his body in terms of knowledge. If we simply say Kshetrajna is the one who knows the body, then there is a problem. Even a rat looking at my physical body becomes a Kshetrajna. But that is not so. The Kshetrajna is the one who looks at his body from within, objectifies from within, just as he objectifies the world outside. The entire physical, physiological, psychological complex, including the causal, subtle and physical bodies, is called Kshetra. The one who knows it is Kshetrajna. Further, Shankara points out that a person knows the body very naturally, swabhavikena, without being taught. Alternatively, his capacity for this objectification may be upadeshikena vedanena, born of the teaching of the Shastra and the Guru. Though it can be arrived at without being taught, because it is an observable fact, still the help of a teacher may be required to point out the distinction between the body and the observer of the body. Otherwise, the body is taken to be the self. Tam veditaram prahu katayanti kshetrajna haiti. That person who knows the body is called Kshetrajna. I know that this is my body. I am there as knower. The body is there as known. Now, the second verse comes, the essence of teaching of Bhagavad Gita, the entire Veda. That is why Acharya said in the introductory Bhashya, Tadidam Gita Shastram Samasta Vedartha Sara Sangrahavutam. This Gita Shastra is the essence of the entire teaching of Shastra. In brief, this is the most important words of Bhagavad Gita that reveals the true nature of the self as one limitless consciousness that is the basis of time-space framework. Revealing the truth of Kshetrajna, Lord Krishna says, Kshetrajnam chabhimam vidhi sarvakshetreshu bharata. This Kshetrajna in all the Kshetras is me only. Know that knower of the bodies, in every body, as me. Kshetrajnam yathokta lakshanam chapi mam parameshwaram asamsarinam vidhi sarva kshetreshu. This is the final teaching of the Shastra. The word mam that Lord uses, he explains as parameshwara. This is the essence, this is the sense in which Lord uses the first person singular here. Who is that Parameshwara? Acharya says, the one who is not subject to samsara, asamsarinam. Everyone understands Kshetrajna to be a samsara. But here he says, the Kshetrajna is identical with Parameshwara, the Lord. And the Lord is not just the Kshetrajna in one given body, is Kshetrajna in all the bodies. Wherever one says, this is my body, there is this Kshetrajna, the Chaitanya that obtains in everybody, every body. Then Bhagavan says, is me. In other words, he is saying, you are me. Every person is me, Parameshwara. It's a pramana, it is. It's a pramana vakya. It has got to be true. It's a challenge for one to see. This knower consciousness, yaha kshetrajnaha brahmaristambha paryanta aneka kshetra upahi pravibhakta, is seemingly divided into countless forms beginning from Brahmaji to a blade of grass. Why seemingly divided? Because only by the bodies it is divided, not essentially. When one sun is reflected in many mirrors, it looks as though there are many suns. But in reality, there is only one. Similarly, one Parameshwara alone is the Kshetrajna, seemingly divided because of the various upadhis such as Brahmaji, Indra, Varuna, Agni, Gandharvas, Yakshas, humans, animals, microbes, trees, plants and so on. In reality, knower consciousness, Kshetrajna, is not divided at all. Therefore, Shankara says, Nirasta Sarvopadi Bhedam. It is free from the differences brought about by the upadis. All the bodies, there is only one Parameshwara, which is you. Further, Shankara says, this Kshetrajna is Sad Asadadi Shabda Pratyaya Agocharam. That which cannot be known by the words that indicate what is Sat, existent, or Asat, non-existent. A term is Sat, it is evident to you as an existing thing. Whereas its state is Asat, non-existent. That is also evident to you. The knowledge of both is and is not is generated by a means of knowledge, pramana. And you, the one who operates the pramana, is distinct from the object known. But here, it is distinct from sad asat, because Kshetrajna is not known as one of the objects, but because of which everything exists and everything is known and is by nature self-evident, self-existent. So there is only one Kshetrajna, and that is Ishvara, and that means what? Where am I? I is Ishvara in essence. My true nature, the true nature of Ishvara are one and the same. Nitya Chaitanyam. Thus, this verse is a Mahavakya. It means I is an over of the body, is not separate from Ishvara, is identical with Ishvara, who is not a samsari and is the cause for the entire world. The entire world, therefore, depends upon me. This knowledge alone is called Jnanam. Kshetra Kshetrajnayo Jnanam Yitta Jnanam Matam Mama. So anything else is called Ajnanam. This is the vision of Ishvara. This is the vision of Shastra. When Lord teaches oneness between me, the Jivatma, and Him, the Parameshwara, it is to be understood properly. The equation is not between Creator Ishvara and created me. So the meaning of the word I has to be arrived at by inquiry, by negating the Kshetras, the bodies, that I am not. The negation culminates at a point where further negation is not possible. And that is called Sakshi Chaitanyam, consciousness, witness, because of whom the body is known. The Swarupa or nature of Ishvara also is to be arrived at by negating the body of Ishvara, which is totality of all Shariras. Then one arrives at the Ishvara Chaitanyam, which is the same as Sakshi Chaitanyam, and it is one without a second. This distinct knowledge between Kshetra and Kshetrajna and the oneness of Kshetrajna in all bodies is the only knowledge that counts in life. Without this knowledge, every other knowledge keeps you in samsara. Because this verse is a Mahavakya, Shankara elaborately comments upon it. In the vision of the Shastra, everything is one Ishvara, one whole Chaitanya, and essentially you are Ishvara, Satchit Anandam Advayam Brahma. This being the vision, there is a necessity, Shankara feels, to unfold it as the vision of the entire Shastra, and he has an elaborate inquiry here. He begins with the view of an opponent to this vision, a Purvapakshi, because vichara is required when there is something to be known, and there are varying contentions about it. In ignorance, there can be any number of contentions possible, all of which have to be answered and negated in order to understand the vision. What was declared as Jnanam is established in these discussions. We will see one of the main objections. We will see an objection is raised about the statement of identity of the Jiva and Ishvara. When Lord says, "Now all the bodies understand the Kshetrajna to be myself," does Bhagavan really mean that I, the Jiva, is Ishvara? Or he means some kind of relationship between the Jiva and Ishvara? The basis for the contention of some kind of relationship is that the Jiva can be included in Ishvara, but Ishvara need not be the Jiva. Like a tree is included in the forest, but the forest is not a single tree. Or, like the ocean is nothing but drops of water, But a drop of water is not the ocean. In the same way, they claim the Jiva is only a fraction of Ishvara. They quote Vakyas from Shrutis and Smritis to support their claim. Dva Suparna Sayuja Sakaya Samanam Vriksham Parishasvajate. This is Mundaka Upanishad. Mundaka Upanishad presents Jiva and Ishvara as two birds. In Bhagavad Gita also, Mamai Vamsho Jiva Loke Jiva Bhutasanatanah. Lord says, Jiva is Mama Amsha. Therefore, this contention of Dvaiti is, if Jiva and Ishvara are identical, then Ishvara will become a samsari. If in all bodies there is a Kshetrajna Atma, I, which is one non-dual Ishvara, then other than that Ishvara, there is no other person. If I am equated to Ishvara, and if there is no other experiencer, then Ishvara becomes a samsari. By knowing I am that Ishvara, there is no gain. I continue to be the same samsari. But Ishvara is always presented as the one who is not subject to samsara. So either Ishvara becomes a samsari or there is no samsara at all. Both are unacceptable. Therefore, this contention. If Ishvara becomes a samsari because he is identical with the Jiva, there will be no moksha. If there is no moksha, there is no bondage either. But this is incompatible with our experience. We do experience a sense of bondage. Ishvara is also a samsari. By merging in Ishvara, there is not going to solve the problem of samsara. Fluctuating emotions, subject-object relationship, problems, fear, birth and death, all will remain. We are eternally bound, which is highly undesirable. If on the other hand, Ishvara is not a samsari, and there is identity of the Jiva and Ishvara, then there is no samsara at all for the Jiva. In that case, what is the purpose of the Shastra? The study of Shastra is declared as a means for moksha, freedom from samsara. When there is no samsara, no bondage, there is no necessity for release. And if we accept that we do not require Shastra because there is no samsara, then it implies that there is no rebirth, no karma, no punya bhava, no sukha dukkha. There is no duality whatsoever because there is no subject-object relationship. But that is not what we experience in life. We have to account for our experiences. Any teaching should speak of our experiences, analyze them and reveal the truth about them. But it cannot go against our experience. Conclusions based on that experience can change in the light of knowledge, but not the experience itself. A stick placed in a glass of water appears to bend. Perceptually it is true, factually it is not. Experience can be explained. Experience cannot be rejected, denied. Knowledge can explain away a particular perception, but no shastra can dismiss perception. Say something that contradicts the pramanas like perception, inference and so on. It can reveal that there is a heaven, for example, which is not against perception or inference because it is not within the scope of perception or inference. But if it were to say that after having gone to heaven, you can remain there eternally, you would have a problem because that is against all reason. Samsara is characterized by pain and pleasure and their causes, success and failure, and the parallels of opposites like heat and cold. A samsari is always concerned about the future. Unlike a sadhu, who lives from moment to moment, the existence of samsara for a jiva cannot be denied because it is experienced by him through the means of knowledge like perception, by witness perception, you experience what happens in your mind. Sukha dukkha, the essence of samsara, the causes for it like heat and cold are sensorial. The desirable as well as the undesirable are experienced by you, and that causes sukha dukkha. Therefore, you cannot say that there is no samsara. Further, samsara can be inferred from the number and varieties of jivas that exist. Why do you see so many varieties of jivas? There must be some cause. One person is wealthy by birth, another is poor. One though poor at birth becomes rich, another remains poor throughout his life. We find varieties of situations in terms of wealth, health, marriage, children, citizenship, talents, career, and so on. All these are not totally self-planned and achieved. From this we surmise that there are a variety of underlying causes. Otherwise, how can we account for these differences? All these become untenable when Jiva and Ishvara are identical. Shankaracharya answers the objection first very briefly and then elaborately. This is the style of teaching in his Bhashya. He himself says, Sankshepa Vistarokto Hi Padartha Sukhadi Gamyo Bhavati Sutra Bhashyoktivat Iti. What is briefly said can be easily understood when elaborated. What is elaborately said can be retained by the brief statement. Sutra is brief, Bhashya is elaboration. The brief answer that Acharya Shankara gives is Jnana Jnanayo Ranyatvena Upapattehe. So simple, so brief. Knowledge and ignorance makes all the difference. The Purva Pakshi's elaborate objection is answered by saying knowledge and ignorance makes all the difference. Shankaracharya says the argument of the opponent is not valid. If the Jiva and Ishvara are identical, the Jiva has got no samsara. This is exactly what the Shastra says. But until you recognize that identity, you have samsara. Everything is proper. Knowledge and ignorance being entirely opposed to each other, under the spell of ignorance, this is all possible. You need to find out which accounts for what. To explain, Acharya quotes many Shrutis and Smritis to point out the difference in the results of knowledge and ignorance. In Kathopanishad, it is said, these two parts, ignorance and knowledge, are far removed from and opposed to each other. Dura nete viparite vishuchi avidya yacha vidyeti jnata. Earlier, the same Upanishad shows the difference between these two in terms of result by saying shreyas and prayas are different. Prayas, the result of ignorance, is something desirable like heaven and so on. Because of the ignorance, I am the karta. I perform karma taking myself as karta. And if everything goes well, the result will be prayas, a karma phala, but which is temporary, anithya. Whereas the result of vidya is just the opposite, which is moksha. As a link in the sampradaya, generally we quote Vyasa, and Acharya does it here. He quotes from the Mahabharata, Dvavima Athapanthanav, Dvav Imav Athapanthanav. There are these two paths are there. One is knowledge, jnana marga, leading to prayas. leading to Shreyas. The other is Karma Marga, leading to Prayas. Under the spell of ignorance, the Jiva is seen as different from Ishvara, and one falls prey to the notions of doership and experiencership, Punyapa, Sugandukha experiences and so on. This is all invalidated with knowledge. But when there is ignorance, there is bondage, the Moksha Shastra becomes valid, as do Karmapala and experiences of Sugandukha. Even in the Gita, the two types of pursuits are discussed. One leading to moksha, the other to rebirths. So, on the basis of Shruti, Smriti and proper reasoning, one understands that this argument that the Jiva is Ishvara, Ishvara becomes a samsari, or Ishvara is not a samsari, there is no samsara at all, Shastra becomes redundant, all these are not proper. The opponent's argument is that if he is Ishvara, there should be no samsara. That is true. If you are Ishvara, there is no samsara, but only if you know this. If you do not know, you will definitely know yourself as a samsari. I am Ishvara, but still I am samsari, you can never say. Therefore, knowledge and ignorance makes all the difference. You are identical with Ishvara, but you have to know it as such. If you do not know, you have samsara. Any limitation is purely incidental, not intrinsic to the self, the I, who is the Lord. There can only be one infinite limitless whole, not two. And consequently, you cannot be separate from the limitless. Nor can it be made up of parts. So the answer is, knowledge and ignorance account for this peculiar situation. The answer is valid. The limitations are due to ignorance of the fact of your being identical with the Lord. Therefore, Shankara says that this ignorance, along with its effects, which are the limitations, has to be removed by knowledge. For this, we have Shruti, the Veda, supported by Smriti texts like Gita that corroborate the Shruti, and also reasoning, Nyaya, that supports the Shruti and supports the understanding, helps the understanding. All the three are important. The Shruti is the source book for this knowledge, and this knowledge can be acquired here, now, in this birth. If you know that the self is identical with Ishvara, the Lord, you are free from the sense of limitation. The body, mind and senses will continue to have their limitations, but they do not cause the self to be limited. That the body is limited is not the problem, because body does not look upon itself as limited. The mind is purely a thinking faculty which can function in the form of cognition, memory, emotions and so on. But it has no sense of limitation. The sense of limitation is centered on the I notion. This has to be very clear. On inquiry, this I, the Ahankara, the subject, reduces itself not to another thought form, but to the content of the thought form, which is consciousness. The one who recognizes that I, the Pratyekhatma, inner self, is identical with Ishvara, sees that he is already free from any form of limitation. He knows that he is the truth of everything. And therefore, the Shruti says, if one were to know this here, there is Satyam, the truth. Ihache Avedi Atha Satyam Asti. On the other hand, if one were not to know here in this life, Nachedihavedit Mahati Vinashtihi. This is Kena Upanishad. The loss is immense. In fact, the loss is infinite. Because what you are losing is the infinite. exactly what you want to accomplish. Infinite is what you want to accomplish. Freedom from limitations is an already accomplished fact. Not knowing that, you have to take yourself as other than limitless, which can only be limited. No matter what you do, you will be the same limited person. From the Shruti, you understand that if there is ignorance, the person is bound. If there is knowledge of the self, he is free. Another Shruti says, the one who knows that vastu in this way becomes immortal here. Tameva vidvan amrita iha bhavati. Taitriya says, vidvan nabibhe kutaschana avidushastu atasasya bhayam bhavati. Knowledge gives fearlessness. Ignorance keeps you in fear. Gita also says, ajnanen avrutam jnanam tena muhyanti jantavah. What is the result of ajnanam? Jantavah muhyanti. People are deluded. On the other hand, one who knows, ihaiva tairjitas sargah esham samye sthitam manah. One who has recognized with samam brahma as oneself, he has won over the creation. There is a Nyaya Tascha also, Acharya Shankara quotes from Mahabharata, Sarpan Kushagrani Tatodhapanam Jnatva Manushya Parivarjayanti Ajnanatas Tatra Patanti Kechit Jnane Padampashya Tatha Vishishtam. See the difference that knowledge brings about. If a place is full of infested with snakes, sharp grasses, well, etc., if you don't know about the place, you will get into difficulties. You may fall in the well, you may hurt your feet, you may be bitten by the snake. But one who knows, jnatva, one who knows, he can avoid them. Therefore, that being so, Jivatma, though being Ishvara, suffers samsaritvam due to ignorance and identification with body, mind, etc. and taking their attributes as the attributes of the self, like taking the post as a person in twilight hours. Yathas thanau purushanischaya. This person is walking in an area which he has heard as having thieves. There is a stem of a big tree on the side of the street, which he sees from a distance in the twilight time. He concludes that to be a thief. He is fraught with fear and goes through the after effects of the fear. His blood pressure goes up, he is sweating, he runs for his life, all for a thief who is not there. Nacha yetavata purusha dharma sthanoho bhavati sthanodharmova purushasya. Just because he has taken the post as thief, post doesn't get the attributes of thief, nor thief gets the attribute of post. Tatha na chaitanya dharma dehasya deha dharmova chaitanyasya. Therefore, just because I take the body as myself, the body attributes do not come to the self, nor attributes of self go to the body. So my identification with the body makes sense complex, and taking their attributes as my attributes, Atma Chaitanya does not get attributed, nor body, etc., get the attributes of Atma. I am sorrowful, I am happy, I am deluded. These are all born of avidya, like birth, death, old age, etc., which are dharmas of the body, do not belong to Atma. So too, happiness, sorrow, etc., do not belong to Atma. So, Acharya concludes that evam cha sati सर्वक्षेत्रेष्वपि सतः भगवतः क्षेत्रज्ञस्य ईश्वरस्य संसारित्व गंधमात्रमपि नाशंक्यम्। वी कैनॉट इमेजिन इवन ए डॉट ऑफ संसारित्वम फॉर ईश्वर इवन दो ही इज द जीवास इन ऑल शरीरास। द संसारित्वम ऑफ जीवास इज इमेजिन्ड वन ड्यू टू इग्नोरेंस अबाउट वन बीइंग ईश्वर। There is no question of Shastra being useless in the absence of samsara because tatha naha kshetra jnanam ishvara ekatve sati shastra anartakyam bhavatu avidya vishyecha artavattu. Even though Shastra is not useful with reference to a wise person, it has usefulness with reference to an ignorant person. Then Lord goes on to describe ज्ञेयवस्तु परमात्मा इन सो मेनी वर्सेस, ब्यूटिफुल वर्सेस आर देयर। सर्वदा पाणिपादं तत् सर्वलोक्ष शिरोमुखं सर्वदा श्रुतिमन लोके सर्वमावृत्य तिष्ठति सर्वेन्द्रिय गुणाभासं सर्वेन्द्रिय विवर्जितं असक्तं। गोज ऑन लॉर्ड ब्यूटिफुली डिस्क्राइब्स दिस क्षेत्रज्ञ। And to conclude the topic, kshetras, bodies, are to be understood as not self. And kshetrajna, I, who knows the body, is to be understood as Ishvara. And this is the means for moksha. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. ओम शांति शांति शांति। हरि ओम श्री गुरुभ्यो नमः।
विदिताखिल शास्त्र सुधा जलते महितोपनिषद कथितार्थनिते हृदये कलये विमलं शरणं भव शंकर देशिक मे शरणं भव शंकर देशिक मे शरणं तव शंकर देशिक मे शरणं।